Now this position here, like I just, you know, I'm not gonna lie, as a guy, you know, I was just like, God damn, you know what I mean? Stop it. Stop it. You know what I mean? Just showing so much legs. I was like, stop it.
Alright, what's going on, guys, and welcome back to part two of Darwin's Game, episode one. Okay, we literally got introduced to, I believe, two more characters. Okay, one was this guy. He was a he's a nah, I don't know his name, but this guy is a crazy guy. His ability is able to cut people up into little pieces. Okay, he does it to this character when he tries to attempt to attack him. Here it comes, and he chops his fingers off. All of it just go. Okay, he does it as well to the man's face and takes off his head. But yeah, and that's that part. His fingers and his head all come off. Now, part two was much more of a finding yourself type episode, and a much more of a this is who is gonna be working against who. Okay, now this man seems to be somebody who's collecting points, who is someone who wants to be a top dog in this game, right? And he's gone and collectively killed 12 people. Now he's done this all with his ability, and he has made short work, just like what this cute girl has said about the 12 people who are also like involved in the game. Now it seems to me that there's a lot of people involved in this game. A lot of people received the notification, and a lot of people have also been placed in the game. So each person that's involved in the game has something called a sigil, which is spelled Sigil, and that is a special ability that they seem to have, which is done through the snake biting them. Now this woman is named the Undefeated Queen, and it goes to show that she just hasn't been defeated once in this game, because she just knows a lot of things in this game. Kaname and the Undefeated Queen go ahead and meet up with each other, and in this scene right here, basically, he's in a dark factory where he meets the Queen, and the Queen wants to basically ask him some questions on whether he knows anything to do with the game. Now Kaname doesn't know anything of the game, let alone his own sigil, but what she's trying to get down the bottom with, bottom down. Ugh, jeez Louise, I can't even get my English properly, you know what I'm saying? What she's trying to say is basically she can't trust Kaname, even though he's new to the game, because he doesn't even know his own abilities, let alone like if he's gonna fight her or not. Like she doesn't know, so she's not taking no risks. Now they're both having a conversation about how to quit the game, and how Kaname doesn't want to be involved in the game, and Kaname is basically trying to like find solutions to get out of the game, and she's basically just telling him that he should kill himself or just die by her hand so she can collect his points. The game slash anime itself is very gory. It's very like death orientated. Like I love the fact that they've all got abilities, which is given towards them by the snake, which is a form of evolution. That is why they call it Darwin's Game, because makes sense. It's a form of evolution, human evolution, that these certain people involved in the game have been allowed to go to the next level, to have abilities that would allow them to survive. Their sigil abilities, or their evolution powers, is as fluent as being able to breathe. You know how you just don't think about breathing? It's just like that. And the Undefeated Queen, you know, said it as well. So it's not like I'm just throwing out rubbish towards you guys, you know what I mean? Now, the only thing about Kaname is that Kaname's ability, right, which he finds out to be, is that he is able to produce objects, not optical illusions, not like fake stuff. Like, he's actually able to produce real objects. Okay, he does this through being able to produce a gun, which he did when he was literally talking to himself and feeling like there was no hope left, do you know what I mean, to the situation. And this is what I really liked about the anime as well, because he's talking to himself, and it kind of tells you like the level of stress he's underneath, do you know what I mean? At the same time, I kind of like the depth and the thinking stages that he explains to himself, which is also towards us, the audience, on the levels of what he needs to do to survive and where he needs to go with this, do you know what I mean? So his whole point of that, he doesn't want to fight, and he has to, in this position, he has to do something. And this message, which was given to him by his friend who died in part one of the episode, as a text, as a reminder to him to survive. So all of this is rushing in his head, and then through that, he's basically able to produce a weapon. Now the first episode, I said that he was able to copy some objects,
and I wasn't sure if he was able to make bio, which was like human things, like living products, living things, living tissues. But it just seems like he can make weapons and like objects that are not alive. Do you know what I mean? So that is very handy, and that seems to be very powerful. At the end of this, he literally makes the girl his... Well, I don't want to say he makes the girl his bitch, but the girl basically makes herself his bitch by surrendering herself and giving up on the and her giving some of her points to him. She also explains a little bit through the confusion of Kaname saying to her if she wanted to die through not giving up, is that people who tend to run out of points tend to die, and that's how they leave that kind of graffiti mark on the ground. It's not through them actually dying, but it's through them actually running out of points. So that's just how the game works. They can't cancel the game right now, but as of right now, Kaname is looking for a situation or a form of answer to end the game. So what she does is submits herself to Kaname, and that's how she loses the game. Now, the second person that we was introduced to, besides the undefeated queen and Kaname, is this person. Okay, we see her connected to three phones. I don't know if her sigil is to be able to spy on people, or if she's actually the creator or the assistant creator to this game, but it seems that she's someone who's watching from the background, which is very dangerous. Now, this position here, like, I just, you know, I'm not gonna lie, as a guy, you know, I was just like, god damn, you know what I mean? Stop it, you know what I mean? Just showing so much legs, I was like, stop it. But, I mean, it's 2020 and anime is trying to develop in a hairy one. I don't know what's going on, bro, but I just know that a lot of people are probably gonna choose this girl right here as kawaii or waifu down the line, just because of the revealings that she's doing right here. But she tells us that his potential rank is possibly an A rank, and she tells us that as well as that, but also his power is not something that can be confirmed through physical effects, and it can't be mind control, or it can't be an optical illusion. So it's a real thing. So that was just interesting. Towards the end, we see Kaname sleeping in the undefeated queen's house. I don't want to show this part because it's quite lewd, but yeah. she's naked in the bed with him, and she's naked in the bed with him, right? And she's just basically saying she wants him to be his missus. So yeah, I don't know if this is gonna, Brad, you know what? That's just the end of the episode review. Yeah, it was a good episode. Part two was lit. Make sure to go watch it. The whole episode is 47 minutes. I'm out. Peace.